Blackstone Audiobooks presents Mystic Warrior,
Book 1, The Bronze Canticles,
by Tracy and Laura Hickman. Thrice upon a time, there was a world that was three worlds, one place that was three places, one history that was told in three sagas all at the same time. Thrice upon a time, the gods foresaw a time when three worlds would become one, when the children of their creation would face the binding of the worlds. Thrice upon a time, three worlds fought to survive. Their children would be armed with the cunning of their minds, their fierce will to endure, and the power of new-found magic. Thrice upon a time came the binding of the worlds. Not even the gods knew which world would reign, which world would submit, and which world would die. From the Song of the Worlds, Bronze Canticles, Tome 1, Folio 1, Leaf 6. Folio 1, The Dreamers. Chapter 1, Far Shores. In the 492nd year of the Dragon Kings, no commoner within the lands of Renard, nor anyone within the five domains, suspected that their world was already coming to an end. The silent invasion moved as slowly and as inevitably as a glacier, unmarked by the busy lives of the ordinary inhabitants. Only the fevered dreamers sensed the initial tremblers of the deep magic, the vanguard of a glory and a doom they could scarcely comprehend. They were the first of the mystics, these dreamers, and they were insane. From the Bronze Canticles, Tome 3, Folio 2, Leaf 19.
They watch me. I feel their eyes peering through the darkness at the top of the falls. Each pinprick in the dome of night burns me, unblinking in its considerations. The stars try to speak, a murmuring of stardust on a wind that I cannot feel. I ignore them. They never say anything of consequence. They babble incessantly about the past and say nothing of the future. Their concerns, it seems, are too far above the lowly place that I occupy. They watch me with eyes of fire. The stars are not the only ones watching me. Dark eyes, holes in the night, peer at me from under the black shadows of the forest around me. Their gaze is lust and hunger. Theirs are the eyes of the hunter, and I am the hunted. I turn from them, stumbling in my flight beneath the low boughs of a pine tree. I might hide from the gaze of the stars here, but the other, unseen eyes are still on me, burning through the darkness. The whispered words between them drift past my ears, talking about me, talking to me. The voices creak and groan like overheated metal, the hiss of steam and the taste of a forge. They are searching for me, licking their long teeth in anticipation. Their voices are most distinct now, chattering madly and incessantly. Demons. They are dark spirits from the deep reaches of Ankara, the belly of the world where all condemned sinners suffer unceasingly in the afterlife. They have come for me in my blasphemy, and they are getting closer. I know this place. These trees are near my home, and yet so different somehow. They can offer me no safety, nor solace. I plunge headlong, mindlessly, through the thick woods. Home is farther and farther from me with each panicked stride, but the demons stand between me and that place of solace. I am spinning, lost and confused by trees that I no longer remember. The branches move too slowly out of the way, marking my face and clawing at my eyes. The trees suddenly part, and I run headlong into the demon's encampment. Four of the revolting creatures have their backs to me as I slide noisily to a halt. The demons are tearing at the flesh of a red-haired scholar, his arms and legs spread wide and staked to the ground. Books and parchment scrolls lie shredded and scattered about. The haggard scholar looks up calmly from the tortured scene.
"Would you be so kind as to help me?" he says in a quiet, patient voice, despite the terror filling his eyes. "Please make them stop." The demons follow the scholar's gaze. "Only my own life concerns me." I leap at once, back into the woods, fleeing, heedless of my direction. Somewhere behind me, the demons scream, spurred into the hunt by the prospect of easy quarry. I hear their panting behind me. I sense the excitement in their squealing voices. They have caught me before, at other times and in other places, but not tonight, I swear, not tonight. The trees, enjoying the sport, now point the way for me, doing their best to come to my aid. But the rocks underfoot are friends to the demons, and one trips me in my headlong flight. I tumble painfully, rolling across the uneven ground. Fear conquers my pain, and, panicked, I push myself up from the dirt. I can see them now. The metal that they wear flashes dully in the starlight. Their steel eyes stare unblinking as they bound through the underbrush toward me. Their skin, too, is green, even in the faint light of the stars. Their smell is an outrageous offense. Their long knives are drawn, dripping from the rending of a previous soul. They clang their blades against their armor as they approach. Hideous grins split their faces. My feet struggle to find purchase in the dirt beneath me. Time stretches thin into an eternity. My legs will not move as they should. My body does not respond. The ground slides beneath me. The demons rush forward.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.